Thank you very much. I'm going to tell you a story about Rula. Rula, Syrian girl, 9 years old, now living in Greece. I'm going to tell you about what she does not have, what she could have, and what she should have. And it could maybe all be summarized into the right to a future. Rula, her school was hit when she was 4 years old in an airstrike. And she had to leave where she lived with her family. And she moved to Raqqa, nearby city. After 3 years where she mainly had stayed indoor, the family had to move on. They had to flee. And on a dangerous journey, they finally got to Greece, where they are now. 5 years has gone. Rula has not been in school. She has been deprived of her fundamental rights to a primary school education and the right to a future. Let's remind ourselves that there are 700,000 children, Syrian children, who are in the situation as Rula, deprived of their right to a primary school education. Another element here is that Rula was on one of those boats that we have seen so much footage about, the drama on the Mediterranean. She survived, her family survived, but we know that the Mediterranean today is the bloodiest ocean in the world, with just this year more than 2,500 people that died in the Mediterranean Ocean. Against this backdrop, I find it incredible that there are so many people still, or now, talking about that refugees, they have too many rights, that we need to scale down, we need to adjust the international instruments, in particular the 1951 Refugee Convention. The refugee system and the human rights system is too liberal, it is being said. I would say what Rula's history tells us and the stories about people crossing the Mediterranean Ocean tell us something different, that there today in the world are too many people who are denied their very basic human rights. So there's enough to do. Let's not forget that all states in the world have signed up to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. It's up to member states or states to implement the convention. We have institutions, UN, EU, Council of Europe, many other institutions, actually to work to assist states to fulfill their obligation to ensure the right to primary school education. So there is still a long way to go. But it is also, and we should not forget that, it is in our hands. We can actually do it. And my postulate today is that we are two, not easy, but possible decisions away from having moved the agenda forward, ensured a better possibility for refugees in the future. That's what I'm going to address. But let me first raise one issue, which is very often coming up, and that is, but we cannot take them all. I think we are far from that. Let me just give you a bit of the proportions in what we are talking about. Consider this island, a super rich island, 1,000 people living there on this island. And then you have another neighboring community which is very conflictual. Two persons are swimming from the conflictual island to the richer, the affluent island. If I now ask you, do you think the 1,000 people could take care of the two? I'm certain that probably everybody in this room would say yes, of course. And they could probably also take maybe 3, 4, or 5. These are the proportions that we are talking about. We are talking about 1 to 2 in 1,000. Maybe 3. Currently, we in Europe cannot talk about a number crisis. A country that can talk about a number crisis is the little country Lebanon, where we are talking about 235 refugees per 1,000 inhabitants. That is a challenge. So in Europe, it's currently not a number issue. It's much more a governance issue. It's an issue of solidarity and trust between member states in order to find common solutions and ways forward. That is what is missing today. But talking about solutions, how do we move forward? What are the steps within the human rights framework? Because it is exactly in these days where, in the times of crisis, where the human rights framework has to demonstrate its robustness. So let's look at what we have in the toolbox of well-tested instruments. And I just quickly run through it. Who is this man? This is Raoul Wallenberg. As I said, I'm director of the Raoul Wallenberg Institute. Raoul Wallenberg, a Swedish diplomat, went out of his way to protect and issue humanitarian visas to the Jewish population in Budapest, in Hungary, in the last months of Second World War, 1944, beginning of 1945. He rescued tens of thousands of people in that terrible situation which prevailed in that period in Budapest. Could we do the same today? Could we actually imagine a world where Rula, her family, and many others actually were taken out, lifted out by with the assist or the help of humanitarian visas to countries in Europe, to the US, Canada, and other places? So they would not have to enter onto those dangerous journeys. It is a possibility. It has been tried. It's possible. The reality is that most refugees are crossing the border into the neighboring countries. We know that. Also in the current crisis with the Syrian refugees in Jordan, Lebanon, and Turkey. So the assistance there is necessary. What we have seen is that for quite some years, the refugees in those countries have lived in a miserable situation. They've lived under the poverty line, a very big percentage of the refugees. And that's one of the main reasons why they started moving to Europe and other places. I cannot think of any other situation where the early warning mechanisms have worked so well and where the early listening has worked so poorly. The international community has, the states have been warned by the UNHCR, the Refugee Agency, World Food Programme, and many others that they simply could not sustain the situation, that they ran out of funding in order to support the refugee populations in those states. It's changing now. It's a positive step that has been taken. It's late, but hopefully for the next groups of refugees, states will be quicker in providing that necessary assistance, which is always called for in neighboring states to conflict areas. But we also know from previous history of refugee crisis is that no neighboring country will accept that the glass just gets fuller and fuller. There needs to be an outflow of people, either by themselves or in a regular way. And what we have seen was that it was very irregular, the way they left Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon. Why didn't they get on the plane, like the Iranian refugees did in the 1980s, or the Tamil refugees from Sri Lanka in the 1980s, far away Sri Lanka? Why couldn't the Syrian refugees just enter a plane and fly to Berlin, Copenhagen, or any other city? Because we, up through the 90s, created a regime where, with carrier sanction, visa restrictions, which basically hindered people in getting on that plane. And we didn't, or any other means of transportation, we didn't provide them an alternative. So we rapidly, by those policies, created a new business area for entrepreneurial people. That is what we call the smugglers today, a gigantic business that was created in those days. Previously, that business area was much smaller. So what can we do? And this is where I would say, this is where we have the first decision of my two decisions. First decision that we need to make, and that is create legal avenues, create better resettlement places for refugees in neighboring countries in need of being moved on to a place in safety. It's in many ways a simple decision. And we could go with the suggestion of the High Commissioner and offer the 500,000 places that has been asked for. Couldn't that be a first decision, a first step? And again, Europe, the US, Canada, Arabic countries taking the lead in this. That would help. But why is it so difficult to make this decision, which is somewhat easy in many ways? The reason is that we have had a climate change. We have a change in Europe and further afield as well, of extremism, of people fertilizing angst and fear on racism, on xenophobia, anti-Semitism, and Islamophobia. Why do they do that? Because they know it's a well-known way to move when you want to harvest political power. It works. Europe has been there before, but we also know what the effects of it is. That's why the first UN convention was the Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, because the world knew and still knows that racism, xenophobia, Islamophobia, where that leads to. It is the prohibition against discrimination cuts across all human rights instruments, international, regional, and also constitutions. We know that it goes wrong, and still it is prevailing more and more forcefully in these days. So the second decision to be made is, let's turn our back to Islamophobia, to anti-migrant, anti-refugee rhetoric, and all those who try to capitalize politically on those negative forces. We need to turn our back at all levels, from the political, from the classroom, into the living room. So that's my second decision. Then some people will say, but isn't there a climate in Europe today where that would is naive, it's not possible? Look at the headlines in the newspapers. And here I would say, no, let's turn the eye to the other groups. Look at how we have seen a civil society in Europe from southern Greece to northern Sweden that has actually assisted, come out in an outburst of humanism, not only for a week, but for months and now years, supporting, taking the refugees on board, introducing them to the local communities. It's amazing. But not only that, we've also seen cities moving. We have cities, my own little city, Lund in Sweden, to Barcelona, to Vienna, to Gdansk, to Düsseldorf. Across Europe, cities are showing welcoming signals, opening their doors. And some cities are even calling for more refugees and saying, where are they? Why do they not arrive? Corporate sector has also taken the lead in this field. They've opened the gates to the workplaces, and we all know that that is the primary route to integration, is to get into that work, be able to sustain yourself, create a living, a livelihood for yourself. That is what creates inclusion. So the humanitarian robustness is there, but we have to see it, we have to get it to surface much more forcefully. Today, unfortunately, it is the more negative, the hate speech that is prevailing in many people's minds. So in conclusion, I just want to say, repeat again, the two decisions that need to be made in order at least to take some important steps forward. The first one being increase the legal avenues to Europe and resettlement so we can undermine the business of the smugglers. And then the second one, let's team up as much as we can throughout Europe, throughout the world, in the xenophobic, Islamophobic rhetoric that is prevailing. It needs to be met everywhere. We owe it to Rula, we owe it to the other refugees that are in need of protection, and I would say we owe it to ourselves as well. We can do it, it is within reach. Thank you very much.